This is an MJA Inc. Investigations Warning. This MJA podcast is rated E for explicit. Some details of a case and language used on this podcast might be upsetting to some of our listeners. Listener's discretion is advised. And for those who are still with us, kick back and enjoy the show. Welcome to our MJ podcast, this series, Welcome to Serial Killer Avenue. This is episode 22, part 2, 8 Serial Killers That Haven't Been Caught Yet. In a world that tends to frown on murder, serial killers are often considered the worst of the worst. It's unreal and unbelievable that anyone would choose to kill people over and over again. It's even harder to believe that there are actually plenty of people like that out there running loose on our streets as we speak. The Murder Accountability Project keeps statistics on murder, thinks that as of 2019, the U.S. alone had something like 2,100 unidentified serial killers running around. We have no way to know for sure which of these undiscovered serial killers are the most terrifying, because they haven't been caught yet. Still, we do know about some of them. What we do know is pretty scary. Let's take a look at some of the most dangerous serial killers who are still out there and about in 2020. But first, we are going to give you the best science that we have on serial killers. It's very educational. You might gain some knowledge how to get into the mind of the killer. What most serial killers have in common. There are 11 main traits that most serial killers have in common. One of the things that terrifies us the most about serial killers is most of their crimes are random. Most serial killers choose victims at random. Many people who have known serial killers have described them as an average person, or in most cases, a very normal person. But average and normal people don't turn out to be vicious killers. But you may have some comfort to learn that most serial killers do have characteristics that can help separate them from all of the others. Unless, of course, you happen to know someone who has all these characteristics, then you probably don't feel comfortable at all. Trait 1. Serial killers often have a personality disorder. Most serial killers suffered from some kind of personality disorder. According to the FBI, that's often psychopathy or antisocial personality. The difference between the two is nature versus nurture. A psychopath is born that way. Their impulse control and emotional centers of his or her brain are undeveloped. Antisocial personalities are learned and usually developed during an abusive or neglected childhood. This doesn't mean serial killers are insane, which is why the not guilty by reason of insanity defense rarely works for a serial killer. In order to be deemed criminally insane, people must demonstrate that when they committed their crimes, they could not tell the difference between right and wrong. Serial killers know very well the difference between right and wrong. They just don't care. Sociopaths, people, and antisocial personality disorder show no regard for right or wrong. They often possess other qualities that are common to serial murderers. They have a lack of remorse. They are callous and have a behavior of manipulations and have no impulse control. It's also important to know that sociopaths are not all killers, and in fact, the vast majority of them are not. So while you might not necessarily be in danger from the sociopath who lives in your neighborhood, you should probably, at minimum, not allow yourself to be taken in by his or her charms. Trait 2. Serial killers exhibit predatory behavior. The calm, purposeful behavior of a serial killer is predatory aggression. Compare it to the aggressive behavior of carnivores. Predatory animals kill to satisfy a need, so there isn't any rage behind the action. A serial killer kills because he or she thinks they need to, while other killers may kill because they are provoked. A person who has a predatory, aggressive personality believes other people are inferior. This makes it easy for him or her to justify hurting or preying on others. Serial killers don't have normal human empathy, but they are very good at pretending like they do. It's vital upon the rest of us to learn how to recognize fake empathy when we see it. In most cases, if your instinct tells you someone is going through the motions when it comes to exhibiting empathy, love, or concern, then your instincts are probably correct. Trait 3. Serial killers are the masters of manipulation. Serial killers are manipulators, but they are also very good at making sure you don't know that you're being manipulated. We all want to believe that evil is something distant. That person we just met, or that person who lives next door to us, couldn't possibly be evil. Due to the fact we like to believe that horror is something that happens in movies or to other people. Jeffrey Dahmer's father accepted his son's lies at face value. It was easy for the father to believe the lies than to admit to himself that his son was a monster. Even those of us who aren't already emotionally invested in a relationship with a dangerous person, you can still be manipulated. Superficial charm can fool just about anyone into a sense of false security, so it's important to be on the lookout for it. If you're being flattered and distracted with gifts, and if those actions appear designed to cover something up, like flaws in a story, the whereabouts of a missing item, or a bizarre favor or demand, you need to keep your guard up. Psychopaths look for your vulnerabilities and try to use them against you. So you need to know what your vulnerabilities are. Trait 4. Serial killers exhibit sensation-seeking behavior. People who commit serial crimes, especially serial rape and murder, often do it because they are trying to feel something. This is called sensation-seeking behavior, and some experts claim there may be a genetic component to it. These experts went on to say sensation-seeking behavior and impulses were not matters of nurture, but of nature. Their meaning is a quality that many serial killers are born with. Some experts found that psychopaths, which make up a large percentage of the serial killing population, they tolerate far more pain than people who are not psychopaths. This suggests not only that they don't fear punishment, but they may be numb to sensations that affect other people in profound ways. Psychopaths don't really fear the consequences of their actions, that they may seek increasingly extreme stimulus since they are numb to many of the experiences that create emotion in all of us. Trait 5. Serial killers often suffered some kind of childhood abuse. Abuse during childhood is not a direct path to becoming a serial killer, but many serial killers were abused as children. A study looked at childhood experiences of 50 serial killers and discovered that 68% of them had experienced some type of maltreatment. either physical, sexual, psychological, or neglect. Earlier research found similar numbers, and one study even reported that 100% of the serial killers studied had suffered some kind of abuse in childhood. Psychological abuse, in particular, has a strong correlation with future behavior. Children who are ashamed or humiliated or just punished disproportionately can develop a propensity for cruelty as a direct result of that abuse. Neglect is a big factor because when children don't experience empathy from a parent or caregiver, they sometimes don't develop the ability to empathize with others. But before we get carried away about serial killers suffered from some type of abuse during childhood, saying that's the reason they are serial killers is very misleading. Millions of children in the United States have suffered some type of abuse or been put in foster care, and they didn't decide to become a killer. I know hundreds of people in that situation of child abuse, and they became productive, law-abiding citizens. I had a childhood friend who was abused by his stepfather, which later the stepfather killed my friend. And I know for a fact that if Rick was alive today and the abuse he suffered, he wouldn't have grown up to be a serial killer. I know him. Nothing got him down. Let's take a short pause for the cause. And when we return, we will profile 6 more traits of serial killers. Be back in a moment. Welcome back to our MJ podcast. This series, Welcome to Serial Killer Avenue. 8 serial killers who haven't been caught yet. We are talking about the 11 main traits of serial killers. Trait 6. Serial killers have a need for control. Psychological disorders or childhood abuse can leave people with feelings of helplessness. A disturbed person with the potential to commit violence, that's a terrible personality flaw. People who feel like they are helpless to control their own lives and situations will sometimes look for a smaller, more manageable areas in their lives that they can have complete control over. If the person lacks empathy, and that area may consist of human beings. Childhood abuse isn't the only factor in a person's past that can lead him or her to develop that oversized need for control. Kids who come from unstable homes, moving frequently, being shuttled between foster homes, they may feel like they have no control over their lives and they don't have the time to develop real relationships with their peers. So not only do they have control issues, they also have a deficiencies in empathy simply because they have so few friendships. Kids with strong friendships learn and develop the sense of empathy that all normal human beings possess. A lack of empathy combined with a pathological need to control others is a very deadly combination. Trait 7. Serial killers often don't show remorse. Serial killers almost always lack remorse. That's not surprising since the ability to repeat a brutal crime depends on not feeling bad about the first time you committed a brutal crime. A lack of remorse isn't necessarily specific to psychopaths or sociopaths, which is terrifying. People who have fairly ordinary psychological makeups can also kill without remorse, provided they can successfully dehumanize the people they kill. Most of the time, the lack of remorse is directly related to the killer's lack of empathy. If you are unable to empathize with someone who is afraid or in pain, and you aren't going to feel much, if any, remorse about ending that person's life. Trait 8. Serial killers are trying to fill an emotional void. People who are engaged in selfish pursuits are almost always trying to fill an emotional void. Some people may not have received much love and affection as children, or they have observed others engaged in selfish pursuits and are trying to emulate that behavior as adults. Serial killers, in particular, are often described as emotionally vacant and incapable of forming meaningful personal relationships. Serial killers may have this quality in common with drug addicts. People who abuse drugs are looking for some sort of emotional experience that can replace the emotional experience they don't have access to, which is usually relationships with other human beings. Having a healthy relationships with others is a crucial component of psychological health. It's what makes us human. It seems that many billionaires also fall into the emotional void category. The relentless pursuit of money, like the relentless pursuit of drugs or murder, is just another way to try and fill the need for love and human affection. Trait 9. Serial killers enjoy having power over others. Psychologists divide serial killers up into categories. There are killers who are act-focused. These people typically kill because they feel they are on some kind of crusade or the feeling that having a just cause for the killing. Killers who are process-focused are more sadistic in variety. They enjoy people suffering, so they usually torture their victims before killing them. The most common type of serial killer is the power control process focused killer. John Wayne Gacy, Ted Bundy, and Dennis Rader all fall into this category. Power killers can be said to have some sort of God complex. They kill slowly because the ability to decide how and when their victims will die makes them feel empowered. Most killers who sexually assault their victims aren't motivated by lust. They are motivated by the feeling of power they get from the act. Trait 10. Serial killers are vain and narcissistic. One of the favorite techniques for interviewing serial killers is flattery. Psychotic killers in particular tend to have a grandiose sense of their own self-worth. Many investigators have and can use praise to get them talking. Behavioral analysis states that psychopathic serial killers don't respond to themes trying to make them experience feelings of guilt or sympathy for their victims because it's just a waste of time. In most cases, interviews might praise the killer for their intelligence or for their skill at outwitting investigators. Psychopathic narcissism is like an immature, selfish, self-centered, resentful, and raging child inside a powerful adult body. Children are inherently narcissistic and must be taught the rules of social behavior. When children grow up physically, but remain in the state of immaturity, they can become extremely dangerous people. Trait 11. Serial killers may have addictive personalities. When normal humans have addictive personalities, they generally find vices that don't physically harm other people. Psychological maybe, but not physically. Serial killers, on the other hand, might also have addictive personalities. When those addictive personalities are combined with the qualities like narcissism, emotional emptiness, and the inability to feel remorse, it's not hard to guess what that might lead to. Some psychologists and criminologists believe there's considerable overlap between personality disorders that are common to serial killers and addiction. Addiction, which can be defined as the repetition of behavior despite the harmful consequences. This often follows a pattern of experimenting followed by a settling on a particular substance or activity. In particular, Ted Bundy displayed these characteristics when stalking and killing his victims. It was known Bundy turned to drugs and alcohol in prison once he no longer had the ability to engage in murder. Other killers, like Israel Keyes, also has been described as addicted to murder. All the 11 traits listed above for serial killers, when seeking to explain the behavior in the most terrifying of criminals, these key 11 traits probably shouldn't be ignored. Let's take a pause for the cause, and when we return, our co-host Olivia will be on the line, and we will be profiling 8 serial killers who haven't been caught yet. Be back in a moment. Welcome back to our MJ podcast. This series, welcome to Serial Killer Avenue. 8 serial killers that haven't been caught. Joining us on the line is our co-host, Olivia. How are you doing tonight?
Doing well.
And when you read the figures from the Murder Accountability Project, what did you think about those numbers?
It's quite dumb. These people are running around the country and no one can catch them yet.
Olivia and I will be profiling serial killers that haven't been caught yet. Serial Killer 1. The most famous serial killer located with the police and the media never got caught was the Zodiac Killer. The Zodiac Killer is the most famous unsolved serial killer case out there. There's a chance that the Zodiac might still be walking among us living. The Zodiac Killer murdered at least 5 people in the San Francisco Bay Area in 1968 and 1969. The killer taunted the press and the police with letters, phone calls, and strange codes. There's a possibility he also committed other murders before these famous ones. The Zodiac himself once claimed to have murdered 37 victims, and he was linked to several other cold cases. Despite the amount of leads, from fingerprinting evidence to witness accounts and a police sketch, and the killer's own constant messages, no suspect was ever arrested, and the killings eventually stopped. Some of the suspects who could be the Zodiac Killer have already died. The fact that we still have no idea about his identity means he could very well still be out there and could be at least in his late 70s.
Serial Killer 2, the mysterious smiley face drownings. Imagine a group like a college fraternity that ruthlessly stalks young and drunk victims. They kill them in a way that makes it very difficult to tell whether the death was accidental or not. Some law enforcement experts think this terrifying scenario is a very real thing. Since 2008, this has been the direction the investigation has been going in. 2 retired New York homicide detectives visited over 40 locations where the deaths took place. This group is targeting young white men with a college education, often after a night of drinking. They abduct them, murder them, and make the deaths look like accidental drownings. The only sign of their involvement is an ominous smiley face graffiti near the alleged crime scenes. It was discovered that some of the over 40 victims have been identified as missing for weeks, but yet their bodies only showed signs of having only been dead for days upon discovery. The bodies also have traces of the infamous date drug GHB, which could have been used to incapacitate the victims before kidnapping them. Even more chilling, some experts believe the smiley face killers might be involved in as many as 335 deaths.
Serial Killer 3, the I-70 Serial Killer. In 1992, Interstate 70 was the dangerous place, and it wasn't because of the traffic. In the spring of 1992 was marked by a bloody trail of a serial killer who murdered 6 clerks in stores near I-70. All the victims were killed in the identical fashion. It started in Terre Haute, Indiana, and ended in Wichita, Kansas. There's little question that it was the same killer every time. The perpetrator used the same rifle in all cases and seemed to exclusively target brunette women. One of the victims actually turned out to be a guy with long hair. The perpetrator didn't just randomly enter gas stations and attack people. Some of his victims worked in shoe stores, some sold herbs and health products. There were several witnesses who described the shooter as a white male at 5'7" with light brown or red hair, was wearing a gray sports coat and slacks. Despite this, the investigators have found the case impossible to crack. There have been no known murders by the same perpetrator since the events of 1992. No one's even been able to establish a motive, and the killer only took a small amount of money from the store's cash registers. The case was still unsolved, and some of the victims' families have been essentially given up on ever finding out the truth behind the deaths.
Serial killer number 4, the Chicago Strangler. Chicago Strangler may sound like a historical villain who stalked the Windy City sometime during the Great Depression. This is one serial killer whose terrifying tale is only beginning to unfold. For around 2 decades, Chicago has seen a series of similar strangulation murders. The first victim was found in 2001. Bodies have turned up in empty lots, vacant buildings, dark alleys, and even garbage containers. Ever since then, there was a short period of peace between 2004 and early 2017. The victims have largely been women with a history of sex work or addiction, and there have been a lot of them. In fact, the Chicago Police Department and the FBI are investigating no less than 51 unsolved murders. This is an attempt to find out whether they might be the work of at least one serial killer. The Murder Accountability Project thinks at least some of the cases most likely are related to a serial killer. This nonprofit group has a serial killer detector algorithm, which has been pointing at a serial killer situation in Chicago for years.
Let's take a pause for the cause, and when we return, we will profile 4 more serial killers that haven't been caught. Be back in a moment. When there is an ending, there was a beginning. Every victim has a picture to paint. Every true crime has its time and place. Please join our MJ podcast, the series Deep Into the Woods, Missing Persons, Unsolved Crimes, and the Does. Welcome back to our MJA podcast, the series. Welcome to Serial Killer Avenue, 8 serial killers that haven't been caught yet. Serial Killer 5, the West Mesa Serial Killer. It is rare to hear officials throw the term serial killer around before they're fairly certain that the homicide cases involve one. The fact is, the city of Albuquerque straight up uses the name West Mesa Serial Killer is a pretty good sign that only one is involved. The West Mesa Serial Killer is an unknown individual who murdered 11 young women, one of whom was pregnant. He buried them in clumsy graves in West Mesa, Albuquerque. The skeletal remains were discovered in 2009. Police swiftly put together a 40-strong task force to investigate the case. It was a bad break in the case when it turned out that the women had been murdered by strangulation sometime between the years of 2003 and 2005. So the trail was colder than anyone would have ever wanted. There has been at least two potential suspects. There have been no arrests in the case. In 2016, only a single detective was investigating the case full time. Families of the victims aren't exactly hopeful that they will get answers in the immediate future. It's possible that the killer may have even more victims than anyone realizes. In fact, apart from the 11 known victims, at least six other women from similar backgrounds went missing in the area between 2001 and 2006.
Serial Killer 6, the Freeway Phantom Serial Killer. This brutal serial killer operated around Washington, D.C. during the ruthless early 1970s. When the homicide investigators in the area were up to their eyebrows in murder cases, the Freeway Phantom Serial Killer stood out. This serial killer's reign of terror started in April 1971. Over the next 17 months, the serial killer abducted and killed six young African-American girls. The killer left their bodies near large roads with plenty of traffic. The case became known as the Freeway Phantom Murders, and frighteningly, the killer was never caught. If he's alive, he may still be out there somewhere. A large part of why the Freeway Phantom was never caught was the fact that he might have been the first serial killer in the area. So apart from the victims' families and a sympathetic detective, no one really knew or cared how to proceed with the investigation. That was until 1974, when the FBI stepped in on the case. The FBI's sizable task force was able to comb through every existing lead and go through hundreds of suspects. Despite some lines of investigation with lots of potential, the killer was never found.
Serial Killer 7, the Colonial Parkway Serial Killer. The Colonial Parkway is 23 miles of beautiful Virginia road running between Yorktown and Jamestown. The stretch of road has seen its share of bloodshed in the shape of a suspected serial killer. The Colonial Parkway murders consisted of eight killings between 1986 and 1989. The similarities between the murders have led some to believe that they might be dealing with the same person. Some theories have suggested that the killer might either be a law enforcement officer or impersonating one. The simple facts, the cars that some of the victims might early, my fault, the simple facts of the cars that some of the victims were discovered with the driver's window rolled down. The case might have faded over time if it wasn't for a former deputy who emerged with a stack of 84 undiscovered crime scene photographs in 2009. The former deputy started butting into the revelation of the investigation at every opportunity. Despite the red flags, the case remains unsolved, and the former deputy died in December 2018. In October 2009, it was reported the situation might be able to change. There is a TV show about crimes in the works, and it centers around an ace team of former FBI special agents who feel that they might be able to crack the case.
Serial Killer number 8, Frankfurt Slasher Serial Killer. The Frankfurt Slasher terrorized the northern parts of the city of Philadelphia from 1985 to 1990. The killer seems to have exclusively assaulted and killed white females who visited the bars of a specific area on Frankfurt Avenue, claiming 8 or 9 victims before the killing stopped. that approximate 8 or 9 figure is due to the fact that a man called Leonard Christopher was convicted of one of the first 8 murders and given a life sentence. Though one more murder happened while he was already incarcerated, he still became the public face of the slasher at the time. Christopher spent the rest of his days in prison for a crime experts believe he did not commit. The other 8 murders remain unsolved. This means that an unknown serial killer might still be on the loose somewhere out there. But there might be some light at the end of the tunnel. During the investigation, the Philadelphia police did actually find a potential suspect, a middle-aged man claiming to be a minister. This person of interest disappeared after being questioned. The police did secure a DNA sample, which was being investigated with new techniques as of 2019.
If you follow the Murder Accountability Project numbers, there is a good chance you might know a serial killer or met one and didn't even know it. Learn the 11 main traits of serial killers that could save your life someday. And Olivia, thinking about this is just the tip of the iceberg.
But right.
Looking at these 8 serial killers that's still running loose, are we dealing with a very smart person that can fool police, or are we dealing with a lucky person?
I think he's calculated, and I think he knows how to get around law enforcement. It seems like I don't want to say it's sloppy police work. It amazes me that these people are just continually getting away with this. You know, I mean, there's got to be some kind of clue that can lead to someone. You know, I mean, they're all over the country. I know we have them here in the Northeast, I don't know. I don't know what to say. It's just, I don't think he's lucky. I just think he knows. You know, it seems like they get away with it once, they do it a different way, but they might change their MO, so it throws the police off. They're used to, they follow one pattern and see, well, maybe it's this person, and then he changes his MO and does it a different way, so... I wouldn't say he's lucky. I just think he's very calculated. And I don't think these serial killers are stupid people. I really don't. You know, that's just my opinion.
Well, the Murder Accountability Project has way different figures than the killers out in the United States at that time. Okay, the Murder Accounting, they had 2,100 serial killers as listed as not being caught. So what do you think the numbers are so different? The FBI says 75 and this project says 2,100.
Because I believe the FBI are only involved in 75 cases. You got to remember, I think the feds usually just get involved if this state lines are crossed. Am I correct?
A lot of times, and then sometimes...
Like in one case we know about, they should be involved.
Right.
Because this person crossed, what, 3 state lines?
Yes.
And yeah, they should definitely be involved. But, you know, a lot of times the police, the state police, say, you know, where I am, we have township police, and if there's an issue, they get the state police involved, or the county police here. Very rarely have I ever seen the FBI brought into anything, and we do have a case in town where a woman was murdered, and this was a couple of years ago, and, you know, it's just like it went cold, you know, and we all kind of know who did it, but I'm sure they know who did it, too, and I think you know who I'm talking about, Mark,
because yes,
we discussed this once before.
Yes.
But I think they're just going by the cases that they are involved in actively. Like I said, you know, they don't. They a lot of times, cases like this, they should call the FBI in because obviously, like Chicago Strangler, the Chicago Police, well, they're involved in that. Are they involved in that?
Yeah, they're involved.
They're involved in that.
Yeah.
But a lot of times, you know, if it's small towns or, you know, it's a big police department, they feel that they have the manpower to solve it. But I think you should call the FBI and they know a little more, you know.
Okay.
Because this person, you know, I mean, we're talking about a serial killer, say, the one in Philly.
Yeah.
Okay. How do we know he hasn't crossed state lines? I mean, what's next to Philadelphia? South Jersey. There's people missing in South Jersey. How do you know he hasn't? People have been killed in South Jersey. How do you know he didn't do that? You know, so I think in cases like this, where there's multiple homicides or murders, that the FBI should definitely be called in.
Okay. I have a quote for you all. In a good book room, you feel in some mysterious way that you are absorbing the wisdom contained in all the books through your skin, even without opening them. Mark Twain. I want to thank our co-hosts for being on the show tonight. I also want to thank our viewers and listeners for tuning in, for y'all have been so kind. Always remember, folks, if you ever get bored with nothing to do, well, take a walk deep into the woods. You might be surprised at what you might find. That's the end of our MJ podcast series. Welcome to Serial Killer Avenue. 8 serial killers who haven't been caught yet. And we say to all of you, good night from Plattsburgh, New York.